Good evening, Pleasant Baptist Church, friends and family. I'm joined by Cameron this evening. He's going to help me with some audiovisual stuff here in a little bit. He's also going to be reading the scripture verses tonight. This is, of course, pre-recorded. This is late Saturday night, so that's the reason why it might look darker than usual in the room. And also why, if something happened in the Sunday morning church service, we're unaware. But as of now, we plan to have old-fashioned Sunday. And at this point, we've already had old-fashioned Sunday. So I hope you guys enjoyed today's services. We're going to conclude tonight looking at the story of the call of Abraham and waiting on God. In fact, the title of the sermon is Impatiently Waiting on God. So if you want to follow along, we'll be in Genesis 12, 16, 17, 18, 25, all the way through the call of the life of Abraham. So buckle in tonight. Give you a chance to find those verses as we get to them. And if you don't find them, don't worry about that. They'll be on the screen here. Impatiently waiting on God. You ever spent more than 10 minutes in a drive-through at a fast food restaurant and thought, man, this is supposed to be fast food? You ever waited maybe longer than 30 minutes to be seated at a restaurant and thought, don't they know I'm hungry? They should be serving me right now. You ever wait on the cable or TV satellite repairman to get to your house and he says, I'll be there sometime tomorrow between 10 and 5? You think, man, who works like that? What happens? Maybe not you, Cameron, but I'm asking the folks out there. You guys ever counted down to payday? 3 more days to payday. I can't wait. Or maybe, Cameron, you ever counted down the days to Christmas? It's 60 days to Christmas. It's 30 days to Christmas. 10 days to Christmas. We count those days down as it gets closer and closer, don't we? Maybe as an adult, you count down the days to the weekend. Oh, it's only Monday. I can't wait till it's Friday and I can get off work and have my time. You ever spent time waiting in the doctor's office thinking, I hate being around sick people. I want to come here to be sick, waiting to go to see the doctor. Maybe you've waited for the test results to come back. I hope it's not cancer. Hope the news isn't bad. And waiting by the phone, perhaps. Maybe you've waited by the bedside of a loved one who's dying, watching them wither away, thinking, I can't wait any longer. I can't stand by and simply watch death take my loved one away. Well, God doesn't wait on anything. A perfectly omniscient, that's all-knowing God, doesn't wait, and he knows when all things will happen. And God doesn't wait because he plans, he ordains, he watches, and he makes things happen. I'll start off tonight with the first text, Isaiah chapter 40, verses 20 through 31.
Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God. He is the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives no power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Thank you, Cam. Appreciate you reading tonight. That was in Isaiah 40, 28 through 31. I promise you'll be in Genesis, and we'll get there momentarily. But we spend much of our lives waiting for the next big thing. No sooner are the Halloween decorations down than the Christmas tree is up. No sooner is the Christmas tree down than the New Year's party is come and then gone. No sooner is the New Year started than the Valentine's decorations and candies are in the department stores. I've come to realize there are just 4 seasons, spring, summer, fall, and Christmas. Those are the 4 seasons. One after another, the seasons, holidays, parties, weekends roll by, seeming to go faster and faster. Life becomes one big blur. You know, life is really a series of waiting, isn't it? We wait to be born. How many days until we're born? Mothers often, maybe more impatient than fathers, ask the question. And they do. I can't wait for this pregnancy to be over. And when is it going to be over? And then guess what? We are here. We're rushed home from the hospital, rushed to the first year of our life. Soon we're rolling over, then we're crawling, then we're pulling up, then taking our first steps. And the baby gates are up. And the coffee table is removed from the living room. Our lives adjust. And then before you know it, it's off to school. First grade. Second, third, eighth grade, high school, school parties, pictures, dances, graduation. I can't wait till I ride a bike like the big kids do. I can't wait till I ride the rides at the county fair. I can't wait till I'm this tall. I can't wait till I got a girlfriend. I can't wait till I'm 10. I can't wait till I'm 13. I can't wait till I'm 16 years old. You know, I can't wait till I'm 18. I can't wait till I leave home. I can't wait till I go off to college. I can't wait till I'm 21. I can't wait till I get married. I can't wait till I have children. I just can't wait until they finally grow up. I can't wait till they leave home. I can't wait till retirement. I can't wait to really start living. And then before you know it, I can't wait to die. The pain of life is unbearable. The kids are raised and gone. The friends I once knew are also gone, or dead, or in rest homes, or in hospitals. James 1, 2 through 3 says this.
Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know the testing of your faith produces steadfastness.
We spend much of our time, as I said, just waiting. So it stands to reason that we should learn how to wait. The sum of our lives is a collection of waiting rooms. We wait to be born, we wait to live, wait to grow up, wait to grow old, and finally wait to die. But the Bible has a lot to say about patience. You've heard about the patience of Job. He was not just the most patient man in the world, but he passed the test. There are other patient people in the Bible as well. Today we're going to learn about a man who was as patient, maybe as patient as Job. So our story today begins in Genesis chapter 12. We're going to read verses 1 through 7.
Now the Lord said to Abram, go for your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and in him dishonors you I will curse, and in all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran, and Abram took Sarah, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran. And they set out to go to the land of Canaan when they came to the land of Canaan. Abram passed through the land of the place at
Shechem,
to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring I will give this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him.
Thank you, Kim. I appreciate that. The promise came to Abraham when he was 75 years old. Until God showed up, he had lost hope in ever having children. He decided that it was never going to happen. And then God showed up. And at 75 years old, God said, you're going to have a child. Now, at this time of life, Abraham, at 75 years old, should be looking for good retirement communities, not good school districts. He should be looking for places to settle down and ease in the final stages of life, and not for a place to start a family. But then God showed up. Instead of buying a hover round, he was going to buy a minivan, right? The promise came to Abraham at a time when Abraham had no hope. At a time when Abraham would have had to have a miracle. Abraham was 75 years old when God said, you're going to have a child. Now, if you fast forward, Abraham is 86 years old when Ishmael is born. He waited 11 years, which seemed like a long enough time. He waited until he could wait no more. He waited until he was just tired of waiting. He decided, as we often do, to help God a little bit. He thinks sometimes that God needs our help. Sometimes God's not as omnipotent as we imagined. Sometimes he's not as wise as we thought he once was. Sometimes God needs our help to make those miracles happen. So in the midst of his waiting, Abraham and Sarai thought they'd help God out, and that was a bad thing. Genesis 16, 1 through 4, and then we'll skip to verse 15.
Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. She had a female Egyptian servant whose name was Hagar. And Sarai to Abram, "Behold now, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go in to my servant. It may not be that I shall obtain children by her." And Abram listened to the voice of Sarai. So, after Abram lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar the Egyptian, her servant, and gave her to Abram, her husband, as a wife. And he went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, she looked with contempt on her mistress. And Hagar before Abram, a son, and Abram called the name of his son, whom Hagar bore, Ishmael. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to Abram.
Very good. And if you don't know the story, and just finding out for the first time, I'll sum that up. Abraham went 11 years on the promise of God. Got the promise when he was 75, and for 11 years, I'm sure of trying, nothing had happened. No miracle, no child. And so Abraham's wife, Sarai, had a great plan, so she thought, why don't you go and lie with my handmaiden? Why don't you go have a relationship with someone much younger than me, my servant girl, and then you'll get the child that God's promised you. And Abraham maybe didn't think about this twice, just enough to say, let's do it, said, that's a good idea. We got to help God out. Well, there's nothing wrong with me having this child through other means, and maybe it's not through Sarah, but maybe another way God has planned. Who knows? But God wants me to take the initiative and do something about this. Well, you know the story. He did have a child with Hagar, his wife's handmaid, and Ishmael was his name. And he was 86 years old when Ishmael was born. 11 years of patience, lost in a single moment. 11 years of trusting, praying, and obedience, lost in a single moment. What often takes a lifetime to build can be destroyed in a single moment. A word, a deed, a glance, a stare, all can be the downfall of a good reputation. Abraham's testimony was ruined in a moment. Abram's family was ruined and destroyed in a moment. Abraham's life was torn apart in an instant. Why? Because of impatience. Impulsivity, immaturity are the reason they can't delay gratification. That's what makes a thief steal. That makes a lustful man rape. It makes an angry person murder. It makes a believer lose testimony. If you don't think that patience is important, look at the life of Abraham. Look at the conflict and the bloodshed in the Middle East even today. All because of this moment in time, two children will be born. Two conflicts, two warring peoples because of this moment of decision. I was speaking to a man just this week, and you heard the cliche. He's waiting on something big in his life to happen. He's waiting for this thing to happen. He said, you know, I'm praying for God for patience. And he said, and I want it now. And it's cliche, but, you know, God doesn't give you patience. He gives you time to wait for patience. Well, the story doesn't end in disobedience. It's a story about patience, a story about redemption, a story about waiting on God. Genesis 17, 1 through 6.
When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, that I may make my covenant between me and you and may multiply you greatly." Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, "Behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be called Abraham. For I have made you the father of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations, and kings shall come from you."
One chapter, and 13 years later, God came to Abraham. This time, it was 24 years after the promise. 24 years of imperfect patience. 24 years of trusting, following, and the worst of all, waiting. God came to Abraham. And here he renews the promise. I am God Almighty, God the powerful, God the omnipotent. Walk before me faithfully and blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Well, the promise, you notice, is conditioned upon Abraham's obedience. He had to be blameless. He had to walk faithfully. He had to trust, believe, and most of all, wait. And what was God going to do? God was going to do the rest, wasn't he? All Abraham had to do was to be obedient and to trust. God was going to work the miracle. God was going to take a lifeless womb and generate offspring. But Abraham had to wait a little bit longer. He had to wait one more year. He had to do something he had never done before. He had to wait through his wife's first pregnancy. They both had to do something they'd never done before. Decorate a baby's room. Go to birthing classes. Go to the doctor's office for follow-ups and checkups. But most of all, they had to wait a little bit longer. God was working faith in the heart of this man. He was still transforming Abraham. He was weeding out the seeds of doubt and sowing seeds of faith. He was going to do what only God could do, take a lifeless womb and make life. Boy, it's type and shadow of Christ, isn't it? Like he would take a lifeless tomb of Christ and make life. That's what this type and shadow about, of course. Let's see what happens next in the story. I skipped some verses. So if you want to read Genesis 17, 15 through 17, right here, it's not going to be on the screen there.
And God said to Abraham, as for Sarah, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarah, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations, kings of peoples that shall come from her. Then Abram fell on his face and laughed and said to himself, shall a child be born to a man who is 100 years old? Shall Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? Abraham did something he had never done before.
Very good. So promise comes to Abraham with a very, very specific disclaimer, right? It's through your wife, Sarah. And notice the name Sarai to Sarah, to mother of a multitude, Abraham a father of a multitude. And it is going to be not through a handmaid, Hagar, but it's going to be specifically through Sarah. Abraham doubted. He laughed in disbelief. The disbelief was not what he could do or what God could do, but in what his wife could do. Sure, God can speak the word and work in the world to existence for sure. But can God make a baby grow in the uterus of a 90-year-old woman? Abraham would do his part. God would do his part. But Abraham says, can Sarah do her part? Well, something happens in the life of Abraham and Sarah from this point forward. The detail is so subtle that you might miss it. Notice what's happened before the birth of Isaac. God changed their names from Abram to Abraham, from Sarai to Sarah. God had already given them the sign of what was about to take place, from exalted father to father of many. That's Abraham's name change. He was never called Abram again. And Abraham, from this point forward in the story, wasted no time in serving God. He immediately, the Bible says, circumcised himself and every male in his household, from Ishmael all the way down to the lowliest servant. The promise was conditioned upon Abraham's obedience. God said, walk before me faithfully and blameless, then I'll make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Now, Abraham was not idle. He was obedient. He was to wait and to work. But his work could not supersede the will of God. He was to wait and be busy at the same time. Abraham was a multitasker, but the wait was not over yet. Abraham had to keep on believing in spite of everyone else's non-belief. Let's see what happens in chapter 18.
And the Lord appeared to him by the oaks of Mamre. As he sat at the door of his tent in the heat of the day, he lifted up his eyes and looked. And behold, three men were standing in front of him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them, and bowed himself to the earth, and said, O Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree, while I bring a morsel of bread, that you may refresh yourselves. And after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant. So they said, Do as you have said. And Abraham went quickly into the tent of Sarah, and said, Quick, three seas of fine flour, knead it, and make cakes. And Abram ran to the herd, and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the young man who prepared it quickly. Then he took curds and milk, and the calf that he had prepared, and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, Where is Sarah, your wife? And he said, She is in the tent. The Lord said, I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, shall have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent door behind him. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in years. The way of woman has ceased to be with Sarah. So Sarah laughed at herself, saying, After I am worn out and my Lord is old, shall I have pleasure?
Very good. Well, you notice there are three people that meet them at the tent, three men. Two are angels. You would see the story as they go down to the plains of Sodom and Gomorrah to speak to Lot. But one is called the Lord in verse 10. It's the Lord. It is a pre-incarnate, a Christophany. It's Christ himself pre-incarnate to come to present himself, to talk to Abraham and Sarah with this promise. That's wild, isn't it? The promise that was through this son, the biological lineage would follow all the way to Christ. He was going to enter the human race through the birth of a child not yet born in Sarah's womb.
Why isn't that in red then?
I just didn't put that in there. But that's wild, isn't it? That Christ in the Old Testament comes and with the very explicit instructions, she's going to have a child this time next year we come visit. There'll be a nursery, a mobile, a high chair, a baby seat. There'll be a stroller, all these things in your house you've never had before. Mark it down. And that's the Lord speaking. And of course, the Lord will ascend back to heaven, and the other two angels will go their way, and they'll come back in a year to check this out. Well, look at the story. Sarah laughs. She's behind the tent, and she's listening behind the door, and she laughs. Sarah laughs. Like her husband had done a few months earlier, she laughed. Her laughter was a sign of unbelief. She laughed because she thought, it's got to be a cruel joke. She laughed because you don't have babies when you're 90. She laughed because barren women can't have babies. She laughed most of all because she didn't have faith. Sarah, remarkably, did not have the faith that her husband had. It was her idea to introduce Hagar into the marriage bed in order to circumvent the promise of God. I mean, there'll be naysayers, of course, in your life. No doubt there'll be doubters, haters, stumbling stones. But don't lose patience. Don't give up on the promise of God. This time, it was Sarah who laughed. She laughed because it was going to take a miracle. It was going to make, God was going to do something that was going to make him have the last laugh. And here we get to chapter 21.
I don't think Sarah deserves to have children.
Well, it's the faithfulness of God, not the faithfulness of Sarah that led her to have the baby.
The Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah as he had promised. And Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age at the time which God had spoken to him. Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whom Sarah bore him, Isaac. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Wow.
Remarkable.
That's crazy.
The child born to their home was called Isaac. Isaac is a Hebrew word which means laughter. God had the last laugh. He gave them this child way past the time they expected. Are you growing impatient? Then wait for God's punchline. I'm going to close out with a song. They called him Laughter. A barren land and a barren wife made Abraham laugh at his wandering life. A cruel joke it seemed then to call him the father of nations. A heavenly prank, a celestial joke, 'cause gray hair and babies leave no room for hope. But hoping was something this hopeless old man learned to do. I waiting on God, he never fails to keep his promises. Let us pray. Father, teach us patience. Make us wait till we learn the lesson. Father, whatever we're struggling with tonight, whatever is heavy on our hearts, whatever we're facing this week, teach us to be patient, to wait upon you, to do all that we can, all you've called us to do, but most of all to wait and trust. In Christ, let me pray. Amen.
God bless.